Good morning and welcome to Bethlehem Live on Facebook, and we'll also be recording this to be shown later, and we hope whatever format and whenever you get the opportunity to visit us here, we hope that the Lord will bless you for coming this way, and we look forward to what God has in store for us today, and we're looking forward for the message from the Word, and today we're going, our message will come from James chapter 1, so you can go ahead and get your Bibles open there, if you will. We'll be getting to that scripture in just a little bit, as we're going to talk about commitment this morning. We talked about God's call last week, and if we're going to accept God's call, we've got to understand God's commitment, so we're going to look at that today. So we hope that you'll join us in just a few moments for that. But in the meantime, before we get our service started, we did want to make a few announcements that you may be interested in, some things that are taking place. Although we're not being able to gather together physically, there are ministries that are taking place and things happening that you may want to make note of. First of all, is the children's home. We will be collecting items for the children's home. A list of those things can be taken. You can go to the children's home website, and those lists are available to you. Also, if you'll contact Tiffany, she'll be glad to share those with you as well. And we could probably even get it posted on our Facebook page, so you can, it is there, so you can glean that from there as well. Get those items in by the 15th of May, because they're going to be taken to the children's home pretty quickly after the 15th, 16th, or 17th, somewhere along there. So there is a bin, there's a tub in front of the Family Life Center that if you'll put your contributions, your donations of goods there, we'll be sure to get those and get those to the children's home in support of them. So do keep that in mind. Also, if you'd like to come by, we have some yard signs available for you to put out in your yard just to support the church and let people in the community know that, one, you're proud to be a member of Bethlehem Church, but also to let the community know that the church is still here, we're still ministering, we're still willing to serve for the needs of our community. So take a sign home with you. I think there's about 15 of them left, and take and place them out by the road to let people know that we are Bethlehem. We are willing to serve. We're here to serve our Lord, and we hope that you'll do that in recognition of the church. So keep that in mind. Just drive through, pick one up as long as supplies last, and we hope that you'll take advantage of that. Also, coming up this, Lord willing, and depending on the restrictions as far as gathering, what might take place later this week and what happened there, we are planning on having a business meeting on on May the 17th, that Sunday night, at 6 o'clock. So we hope that we'll be able to gather for that, but we will be making adjustments as needed, as we need to do that. But plan on that business meeting Sunday night on the 17th of May at 6 o'clock. And also on the Monday night Bible study for the women will begin on May the 18th. Also, there might be some adjustments to gathering as that as well. We're discussing with Gail and about possibly doing an A and a B session so that those can come to an A and come to a B to divide up those. That just depends on the ruling and where we are as far as gathering is concerned, so that we can do that in abidance with the guidance that's given by our government. So keep that in mind, if you will. But put it on your calendar. Monday, May 18th, we'll start the women's Bible study. So be much in prayer for that each and every week, if you will. It's going to be a good Bible study, and we hope that the ladies, that you'll take advantage of that and let Gail know as soon as possible if you can come, and so she will be able to make the adjustments that need to be made as far as attendance is concerned. And I think I've covered the announcements that I know about, unless somebody throws a flag up at me. But do keep those things in mind. If you have any other announcements, let's do this. If you'll message me in some way, I will be glad to put that on Facebook. We'll do one call to try to get the word out about different things that are taking place so our people will know what is happening within our congregation, okay? And this time we're going to go straight to the Lord in prayer.
the service this morning, definitely lift it up as we worship the Lord, that God will truly intervene in the midst, and that the person of the Holy Spirit would just fill this place, the homes that are represented throughout our communities that are tuning in to this broadcast, that God may be glorified in all that takes place. Also continue to remember those that have been requested. The Reverend Ashley Summerlin, keep him in your prayers. He's doing well, and we're glad to hear that. And also, Ms. Joanne Bowman, keep her in your prayers as well. She's a lady here in our community. Do keep her lifted up. And remember the different ones that are dealing with the coronavirus head on, our nurses, our first responders, continue to lift them up. Remember our president and his staff, the task force, our government across our counties and state, that good decisions to be made, our economy, and those that have lost their jobs. And we do pray that you join us in prayer with that. And do keep all of this in prayer before the Lord. And as we go to the Lord in prayer, and I see some requests coming across there, we just want to remember those and keep them before the Lord as we go to prayer. Let's pray. Our Father, you're a good God. How great you are in all your works and all your deeds and all that you love and compassion and patience that you have towards your children. And Lord, as we come together and worship, we may not be in one place. We may not be in your house together, but Lord, we know that through the medium that is available to us, the technology that is setting for us, we know that we can gather together and worship you. And we ask, Lord, that we might unite together in prayer. Lord, that the Spirit of the Lord might move in our midst. Lord, even in this time of uncertainty, this confusion, this difference that we're going through over the last weeks, you have touched people's lives, and some exciting things are taking place, and we're so thrilled to be able to be a part of what you're doing in people's lives. Souls that are being saved, announcements that are yet to be made, and we're excited about those things as God moves in people's lives. And we ask, Father, that you continue to do that. Lord, through the breaking of your word, that Lord, through the text, through the preaching, through the singing, through all of these things, that your name may be lifted. Be with the sick, those that have requested for prayer, those that have had surgery, those recovering, those that are going into surgery. We lift all of these up to you, that you may be in the midst of all of their lives to bring healing, Lord, and deliverance in their need. We thank you, Father, for your presence. Lead us, we pray. Bless us with your your hand as you lead us every step of the way. In Jesus' great name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. At this time, as we come to a time of worship and our offerings, we do want to continue to remind you of the importance of your tithes and your offerings to be brought into the storehouse, to be able to be given to the Lord in order to respond to the needs that are around us. Again, there are several platforms, and we're going to walk through those for you. One is a new app that we have bought into, if you will, that we're sharing, that you can use as online giving, called Easy Tithe. If you'll go and find an app, and I think the screen is there, you're probably seeing that. Find that app, if you will. Download it on your mobile device, and as you get that downloaded, it will walk you through the steps. And I think Tiffany's got those slides available. And as she walks you through those slides, just take a look at those. That once you get those things taking place, you use our zip code. And if you don't know that, it's 28521. Bethlehem OFWB Church will come up, and you'll just click on that. You'll go and create your account, the information that is needed, and you'll be able to give through your mobile app that way. Now, one of the other ways, most of you, if you have access to a mobile device and you do mobile banking, if you'll look on your mobile app for your bank account, there's a section there that's called Bill Pay. You can go there and set the church up and pay through your account directly to the church. There's no service charges available there or applicable there, and you can give directly to the church through bill pay. So that's another way that you can give your tithes and your offerings to your church. You also can go to our website,
and click on the donate button. And through PayPal, you can give through that means as well. And also, you've got the everyday mail. You can mail your tithes and your offerings in. So there's a number of ways that you continue to give. So take this time as you pray, as you have a time of silence there in your home, to dedicate this time to the Lord and your offering. In fact, we have a song that we're going to sing, and it's going to be a video. Sing along with it. Most of you know it. It's a fairly old, older worship song that we can sing together and worship. And as you do that, this will be a good time to get your tithes and your offerings together and worship Him. Great is our Lord. Let's worship together in this time.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope and you restore every heart that is broken.
Sing it to him.
Great are you, Lord, 'cause it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
You give life, sing it out.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
Sing to him, church.
And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Sing it.
Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you. Oh, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out.
Great is our Lord. It is His breath that is in our lungs that gives us the ability to praise, to breathe, and to live. So thankful that we have those blessings that set before us. Again today, if you have your Bibles, turn to James chapter 1 in your text as we look to the scripture this morning for the message, as we talk about God's commitment, and we hope that this is not going to be one of those jump and shout type messages. You're not going to, probably won't be too excited, and I want you to know I love you, and this is not a message to beat you over the top of the head with nothing. I just want that this is just where we are, and we need to understand the commitment that God would have us to have. And so look in James, if you will, in chapter 1, and we're going to begin reading in verse 19. It says, "Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath." Swift to hear what? God's word. Slow to speak, slow to question, slow to just let God speak, slow to wrath. Verse 20 says, "For the wrath of man worketh not for righteousness of God." Wherefore, and pay attention to this verse, this is where we're going to kind of rest a little bit and stay at for a period of time. It says, "Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. If any, says, be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like a man beholding his natural face in a glass or a mirror. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh unto the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed indeed." Verse 26 says, "If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion, undefiled before God and the Father, is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to help or to keep himself unspotted from the world." And that's reading through verse 27. May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his word. God's commitment. That one verse in verse 21, it says to lay apart from all filthiness, the excess, if you will. Lay apart the superfluity, the excess, the abundance of sinfulness. And receive with meekness the engrafted
word, which is the word of God, that is able to save our souls. We're going to spend some time talking about the commitment that God would like for us to use and have through the word of God, the grafting process into the natural man, the natural part, the sinful man, the engrafted word of the holy word of God that brings salvation to the life. That's where it's all at. The Bible tells us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what? The word of God. It is the word of God that brings healing, that brings salvation, that brings correctness in our life. And we need to cling to that and understand that it doesn't happen overnight. This, for instance, if you had an injury that required a skin graft, they would go in and they would take skin from one location and they would place it on top of, I'm not a medical doctor, so I don't know exactly what's taking place, but they would take that skin from one location and place it on top of where they're trying to graft the skin, and over time, that skin adheres itself and begins to be a part of where it's grafted to. And the same thing takes place with the engrafted word of God. It takes some time. It takes some commitment to come to hear the word of God. It takes some time. It takes some commitment. It takes some cost for us to study the word of God and understand the word of God and have the principles applied to our lives. It doesn't happen automatically. The word of God needs to be engrafted into our hearts and our souls, so that we can be saved, so that we can continue the process of leaving the old mortal, the abominable, the ugly, the sinful part, and coming to be that new creature in Christ Jesus, the engrafted word of God. Our commitment God would have for us to make is to understand that commitment takes time. It takes effort. One of the things that I've noticed over the years, especially I would say in the last 5 to 10 years, people today really don't get married. Oh, they have the ceremonies. They get the certificates. We throw rice at them. They have big receptions to celebrate the ceremony. They move in together and they take advantage of the tax deduction that they have, and all that takes place there in the marital bliss of life until the wind starts to blow, until conflict comes up and they split their ways, dissolving the union. They're not committed. They're not committed. That's not marriage. That's just wanting some partnership. That's just wanting to have someone in the home so you won't be alone. We need to commit to marriage. And this is the commitment that God calls us to understand that the life is not going to be easy all the time. And in order for us to have healthy relationships with God or with others, we need to understand it can't be all one-sided. But we are living in a society, and yes, in a generation today that wants to take all the time. What's in it for me? Give, give, give. And this Generation X and all that takes place in the definition and how to reach Generation X. We need to teach them that it's not all about taking. They got to be willing to give occasionally. That's how a healthy relationship happens. That's how a healthy relationship survives, is that you're willing to give as much as you take. Even God told the farmers, even God encourages those that tills the soil, that occasionally you need to let it rest. You need to let it rest because you can't continually take of the nutrients and take of all that the soil has to give if you don't stop and put something back into it. It's going to stop growing stuff. It's going to become a place of desolence. And that's what happens in our relationship with God. That's what happens in our relationship with others. We're continually taking and taking and taking and never giving nothing back into it. God's commitment calls for us to receive the blessings that He has to give, but He also encourages us to give. He encourages us to give of our time, ourselves, in order that our relationships can be healthy. Oh, anyone can get a job. Oh, we all want to draw a paycheck. Amen? We all want the paycheck. We all can get a job. But it's those that are committed that makes the difference. Those that really commit to their job, that their work, their trade means something to them. That they don't just go and throw something together. I've seen tradesmen, carpenters that were committed to their trade and how they could do such beautiful work. When another person that comes along that's just collecting the paycheck, that really don't care about their trade, just slaps something together, and what difference it makes in the commitment. God wants us to have commitment. He don't want us just to be. He wants us to commit. Let it mean something. Let the production of our life to be doers of the word, not just hearers, but do what we've been told. Do what we read in God's word, that we might not just draw a paycheck, but that we're committed to the craft. I don't know how many times in counseling that I've heard people come and talk about getting married. And one of the first things that comes out of their mouth, He won't let me be who I am. He expects me to change. Or she expects me to change. I got news for you. You can't own a goldfish and it not change you. You can't own a dog and it not change your life. If you didn't want your life to be changed, you shouldn't have got married. You need to know that in the midst of our life, as we commit to the Word of God, it's going to change you. You're not going to be the same person tomorrow as you commit to the Word of God and you become a doer of the Word of God. You're not going to be the same person tomorrow as you are today, because it's going to change you. You're going to talk a little different. You're going to act a little differently. God will instill in you different values. And that's what he says. James says in verse 21, lay apart those things, that excess of iniquity, of sinfulness, and receive with meekness the engrafted Word of God. The commitment to serve God on a different level. You got married, you took the job, you joined the church. Oh, we've got people that's joined the church you probably hadn't seen in 50 years. There's no telling what kind of crowd would gather if everybody who belonged to Bethlehem Free Will Baptist Church would come to church one Sunday. Oh, we joined the church, but we just sat out there on the edge. And I got to thinking about it this past week. And I meant to share it with my family. I didn't think about it. It's just one of those things. And it just, the way my mind works sometimes, we're sitting there eating. And one of the things that my dog loves to do is hang around the dining room table when we're eating. He's even figured out that if there's not anything that falls from the table at one person, he'll go to another table or another place, and he'll sit and he'll wait. He'll go around and around and around until somebody drops something, either intentionally or unintentional. I do have a grandson that will accidentally drop something from the table, but I began to think about that. That's how we are sometimes as church members, as Christians. We hang around the edge waiting for the puppy dog blessing, waiting for something just to fall off the table. When if we would just come to the table of God, if we would just commit to His Word, God has a tremendous blessing for us to receive, because He's not just a Las Vegas roulette machine. He's not the lottery. He's a sure God. I am that I am, he says. He promised Abraham and said, he told Abraham, I swear that I will bless you. God wants to bless his people. He wants to open up the windows of heaven and bless his people. But the problem of it is, he's looking down on a bunch of people that's not willing to commit to the Word of God. That's not willing to commit to the call of God. All we want to sit around the table and get the scraps. When God says there's a buffet meal fit for a king, if you just come to the table, commit to serve. Oh, we live in a generation today that don't want to commit. They'll join the church. And you may see them on Sunday morning, but don't talk to them because they got to get out the door and get home. Don't think you'll see them on a Sunday night service. And don't even mention Wednesday night. Forget it. But they want all that they can get. They want to draw. They want to know what's in it for me. But not willing to commit to do, to serve. Not only does it take some time to serve and to commit, but it takes service. It takes willingness to work to be committed. What good is an employee? What good is a worker if he's not willing to commit to work? Now, I've been around those that's willing to work. I've been around those that they don't know what, they love work. They're not afraid of it because they'll sit around and watch it all day long. But we need people that's willing to commit to work, to put their hands to the plow, to do the things that's got to be done. We've got people here today that's been here since 9:30 getting things set up for 11 o'clock worship service so you can be blessed at home. We need people willing to be committed to work and to labor. We've got people that are working diligently to be able to minister to those that just can't get together. Just past week, our youth director got together and putting some stuff to be able to put into the hands of our kids so they can learn a lesson about how God can transform their life. Commitment. Willing to work. Willing to do what needs to be done, to be doers of the word. To lay aside the excess of unrighteousness, to take upon us the engrafted word of God. It's not an easy process. In fact, I've talked to those that's had skin grafts. It's uncomfortable. It's hurt. It's painful. And sometimes as we have the engrafted word of God into our lives, it's a two-edged sword, the Bible says. The scripture teaches us that the word of God is a two-edged sword cutting asunder. It cuts coming and going. And it hurts, it's painful. But when we allow the engrafted word of God, we learn that we're to be doers of that word. Not just someone that will look at the surface mirror and see our reflections and walk away and forget our imperfections. Oh, we need to be committed to serve and to labor and to work for the kingdom of God. Commit to a God that is a sure thing. He's not just a one-day thing. He's just not a splash in the pan. He's a sure God. And he can bless us beyond measure. And he can do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. Commit our time. Commit to serve. Commit. Commit to his blessings. One of the things that if you know anything about friendships, it takes time, but it also requires for us to be a blessing, to serve one another. And we need to take that seriously. When we accept the ability, when we accept the opportunity to be a friend to somebody, we need to take that seriously. That we're there for them. We've got their back. They can call on us. They can depend on us. That takes commitment. And that's the kind of commitment that God wants us to have with him. That we'll be there for him. That we'll not only just take, but we'll be willing to give. To give our praise and to give our worship. To give our time, our labor, and our talents, our treasures. So that God can be anointed. He can be blessed and worshiped and honored. The commitment that God calls us to. It's a great commitment. It's a great commitment. You know, greatness, or I think it was Tony Evans I heard say, greatness doesn't go on sale. And the first time I heard that, it didn't register with me. But I got to thinking about it. I've never bought one. But it's kind of like if you go buy a Rolls Royce. You don't walk into that place wanting to make a deal.
You don't go in there and say, well, why don't you take 20% off that Rolls Royce for me? Because you know what they'll tell you? They'll ask you to leave. Because greatness costs what it costs. Think about that. If you can't buy, if you have to ask how much a Rolls Royce costs, you don't need to be there. That's what they'll tell you. Greatness doesn't go on sale. There's not a blue light special for greatness. It's earned. You work for it. You commit to it. And God's a great God. And all the blessings He has. And folks, you need to know that He was willing to yield those. He's willing to give those blessings to those that are willing to commit. But it's not going to go on sale. You've got to earn it. And I'm not talking about earning your salvation. I'm talking about committing to God. Committing to His call. Committing to His word and being the child of God that He's called you to be. There are so many church members, so many Christians that are living their lives every day only halfway because they've not accepted the call of God. They've not been willing to commit to what God's called them to do, what God has called them to be. They're not living up to that standard. They've not thrown themselves 100% into nothing that God has led them into, and they sit back and they wonder, why am I not being blessed? You want the greatness of God? Commit to Him. There's four areas of our life that requires commitment. I'm going to run through them right quick and hope you understand them. First thing, and the first thing you should commit to is God. He's the one that gives you life. Your mama may have given you a body. Your daddy may have bought you a bicycle, but God gives you life. He breathes into you the very breath of life. He breathes into you the ability for your heart to beat constantly. And you don't have to stop and think about it. You don't have to stop and tell your heart to beat. You don't have to stop and tell your lungs to breathe. God instilled in us the ability, the electrons in your brain, to continuously over and over, time and time again, for that heart to beat, your lungs to breathe, and all the things that take place. God gives you life, and He deserves our commitment. He deserves our commitment. He deserves for us our jumping around and shouting and hooping and hollering. That doesn't do anything for our commitment. Our commitment is the decisions that we make. Our commitment is about that which we surrender to an awesome God. He deserves our commitment. The second area of our life that we need to commit is our family. Our marriage. The preacher years and years ago that wrote those vows that's repeated so often, for better or for worse, for sickness and in health, he was telling you up front it's not going to be easy. He was telling you up front that there's going to be troubles. There's going to be trials. It's not going to be all roses. It's not going to be all beautiful. And it's not going to be all of this, that, and the other. But there's going to be troubles and trials. And folks, you need to know that in the midst of our lives that we live, there's going to be some hard times. You're not going to always love me like God loves me. You're not going to always like me. But by the grace of God, hopefully you'll love me. Oh, committing to yourselves, to your family. So many children today, so many, I see it, and we all see it. They lose track of the commitment to family. Mom and dad, you know what it is to be moms and dads and raising your children. When they're little, they vomit all over you. They do all kinds of things to you, but that's what they're supposed to do. They're babies. And you clean their diapers, you clean their face, you dress them up, you love them, you feed them, you care for them, and you make sure they grow the best that they can. And somewhere down the line, when the tables are turned and when mom and dad grows old, the children go off somewhere. We forget about commitment. All those times mom and dad wiped your rear end
and mom and dad needs help and they're growing old and they need to be dependent on someone else. Where's the children? They've lost track of the commitment to family. Husbands lost track of their commitment to their wives. Wives lost track of their commitment to their husbands. And it's just breaking apart and falling apart. We need to be committed to our families. Men, this is extra. I'm not going to charge you nothing extra for this. When you seen that woman you wanted to marry, you worked hard to get her attention. You worked hard to win her affections. You worked hard in order for her to say that she loved you. You worked hard for her to say yes when you asked her to marry you. Now you worked hard to get her. You better work hard to keep her. Women, you married the crazy man. You knew he was crazy when you married him. Stand by him. Continue to love him. Commit to that marriage. Commit to that man. Commit to that woman. And those crazy children. We've got crazy men and crazy women marrying each other. You're going to have crazy kids. Love them. They're your kids. God puts you in this face of this earth to be parents to those kids. Commit to those kids. Those kids are your kids regardless. If they're hooked on crack, they're still your kids. If they're in jail, they're still your kids. If they marry and you don't approve, they're still your kids. If your teenage daughter comes home pregnant out of wedlock, she's still your child. That doesn't erase the commitment that you have to love your kids, to love your family. We need to be committed. We need to be committed to God, to our family. We need to be committed to our church. Oh, but it's hard to find those that are willing to commit to the church. We find those that's willing to commit to the Shriners Club, to the civilians, whatever, civitan clubs, all these different clubs and social outings and this, that, and the other. But it's hard to find those that are willing to commit to the church. This generation just don't want to commit to the church. Folks, the church is, we've found out in the last 6 to 8 weeks that the church is more than just a building. But the building is the house of God. And God says, he told Moses way back to build a place that I can pull my people together, that I can dwell with my people. This is a place that God calls us together as a body of believers, that we can worship him, that we can hear from him, that we can serve him and serve others. We need to be committed to our church. Fourthly, we need to be committed to our relationships. There's a lot of ways to be committed to our relationships. A lot of times it's not easy to be committed to friendships, to marriages, to churches, to God. But our relationships are so important. We need to commit to them. In the Old Testament, in chapter 28, 29, somewhere along there, I may be wrong. But it's in the book of Genesis, I know that. Jacob went to find a wife. And Jacob came across Rachel, and she blew him out of the water. She just blew him away. So he went to her father, as the tradition, the custom of that day was, and made a deal that he could marry his daughter Rachel that was beautiful. And the commitment was for 7 years. Now, there was another sister. There's always another sister. And the Bible says, King James says that she was tender-eyed. She wasn't pretty. In fact, some of the word studies come up that tender-eyed probably meant she was cross-eyed. You didn't know where she was looking when you looked at her. She wasn't. Her name, Leah, actually means gazelle. But she wasn't pretty. So Jacob was tricked. And instead of getting Rachel, he got Leah. And in the midst of this, he stayed committed. But I want you to note that in the midst of what God is doing in Jacob's life, Leah was not liked. She was looked down on because she wasn't pretty. She wasn't this. She wasn't that. But in the hatred, and I love this passage of scripture, and this ought to be good news for anybody that's struggling with self-esteem, that is struggling with position, struggling in the place they belong. This should be good news for you. Go back and look it up. God says, because they hated her, he opened her womb. He blessed her with children. He blessed her with Reuben and Simeon, Levi and Judah. He blessed them. Reuben, a child, a son is born, thinking that in the midst of the birth of this child, she might would get Jacob's recognition and Jacob's appreciation. Simeon came along and he was a man child, and he was, his name actually means hearing. Then Levi came along and she birthed Levi to be joined. And then there was Judah that came along, and his name simply, let God be praised. Look at those sons. What's taking place? A beautiful outline as we understand in the midst of commitment. You can't have one without the other. You can't skip from hearing the word of God from Simeon to Judah just to praise him. You've got to have that Levi in there. You've got to be joined to something. You've got to be committed to something. You've got to be committed to God and committed to his church, committed to the family, committed to relationships so that you might blossom and you might bloom. And Jacob committed to what he promised. Have we committed to God? Have we committed to God our lives, our circumstances, our families, our relationships, our labor, our skills, our abilities, all that God has given us opportunity to do? Have we committed it to God? Our careers, our businesses, have we committed those things to God that God might through them use you to do things of greatness for his kingdom's sake? Have you surrendered those things to God? Do we stand committed no matter what the circumstances to know? Oh, you may not be liked. You may not be appreciated. But God stands ready to bless you if you'll stand committed to him. What about it today? Will you be willing to surrender to Jesus today? Commit to him. And I'll be honest, as a pastor, I'm concerned. And I think there's a tremendous test of our commitment coming down the pike. It's been 6 weeks since we've gathered together as a congregation on a Sunday morning. Will you come back when we're able to gather? I'm just asking a question. It's going to take some commitment. Oh, it's probably been different. Some may even consider fun to sit at home in your pajamas and worship. Are you going to be committed to get up on Sunday morning and get dressed and come to church when we are able to do so? I think our commitment is going to be tested. Are we going to be committed in our giving? Are we going to be committed to our service to the kingdom through all of this time of solitude and isolation and distancing? When we can come back together, are we going to be committed to get back to where God wants us to be? Together. Oh, I know the church isn't just this assembly. I know some of my preacher friends are going to comment. They're going to say this, that, or the other, but it's okay. Are you going to be committed to your church? Are you going to be committed to the call of God? And as James puts it, are we going to be willing to receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save our souls? And God's word is simple, that we give ourselves
not just to not just to superficial things, but we commit to the very Word of God, that we surrender to Him. We're going to close this morning with a song. And I want you to worship Him. I want you to listen. And if you are willing to make a commitment, if you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, and you've come across this stream, and you're looking and you're hearing this message, and you know you need Jesus as your personal Savior, as this song is played, and it's a familiar hymn of the church, and you probably know the words, sing along. The words are going to be on the screen. But more importantly, if you want to commit to Christ today, will you do so? Just simply pray. Ask God to forgive you of your sins. Ask Him, Lord, to help you go to a deeper level of commitment. Help you surrender your life at a deeper level that you might be pleasing to Him, that you might humbly receive the engrafted Word of God, the process. Yes, it's painful. Yes, it takes time. But it saves your soul. Will you do that? Listen to the song, sing with you, if you will, and let's just worship Him together. I surrender all.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Thee. I will ever love and trust You in Your presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all.
Jesus' great name, we honor you, Father, in all that you've done, all the blessings we received, the calling upon our life. Help us, Father, be willing to commit to that call. Take it upon us, that engrafted word of God, for the saving of our souls, to be changed, to be transformed from the old sinful self to a brand new creature in Christ, to have relationship with you, with others. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you for tuning in today. Thank you for joining us through Facebook. Thank you for taking the time to view this worship service. God bless you this week. Remember, our Bible study at 7 o'clock Wednesday night will be going live from there as well. And we hope that you'll join us as we continue the Desert Academy and worship in that form. God bless you, and we'll see you the next time around. We love you. We're here to serve you.